Good morning. Did you, you know, there was this rumor I heard, you know, with Halloween right around the corner, that Dracula is depressed. Did you all hear about this?
No.
No, he's depressed. He hasn't been invited to any parties at all. Hmm. Do you know why?
No.
He's a pain in the neck.
Oh, but I'm wrong.
All right, on that note, let's stand up and start our service.
Welcome to worship at Little Bonfim Baptist Church. I am back. Glad to have Ruth back. We continue to pray for Bart. Hopefully he will be out and back next week. This morning, just a few announcements. The Finance Committee will have a meeting Sunday, November 1st, 6:30 p.m., socially distanced here in the sanctuary. We are still collecting caps, scarves, gloves, and coats for Warm Up Columbia. You can drop them off on Sundays or during the week, or Joy Miller has said she would be happy to go and pick them up if you let her know that you have things to donate for that. Also, don't forget about Daylight Savings Time, October 31st, or you'll be off next Sunday, I guess. Starting in November, we'll be taking the local missions offering. In November, it goes towards the global missions offering for the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship. I believe those are all the announcements. There are more in the virtual bulletin or in the emails that you can refer to. And with that, let's continue worshiping. I figured while we were already in it, we would keep going with politics. And so today I'm going to share with you a little mix of some of the things I've been working through with my students this week. For us, it's more than just one thing. So this is kind of a hybrid. It's part of my sermon from Thursday night. It's part of what I discussed with my freshmen on Tuesday night. And it's part of a special event we had on Monday night to talk about judgment and justice. So we've kind of meshed all those things together. It's been kind of a busy week as far as the way we're talking about things at the BSU. But we're going to go back to Galatians. And in Galatians, we see we're talking about the law. We're talking about the Torah. But we're headed towards something else. We're headed towards this fulfillment of the law in Jesus. And in Galatians 3, starting in verse 23, it says, "So in Christ Jesus, You are all children of God through faith, for all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Today we continue to pray for those in our congregation who are out sick. The numbers with the coronavirus are still going in the wrong direction. Most states are setting record highs, and so we see that we are not out of the woods with this yet, and so it is still a concern. And one that we have people in our own congregation. I have students who are quarantined right now, some with coronavirus and some because they live with somebody with coronavirus. Those quarantines, when you get four guys who are living together and one gets it, sometimes it takes them a month and a half before they're allowed to be out of quarantine. So they're best friends right now. But no, we continue to pray for these things and many other needs within our congregation and within our country in this particularly divisive time. So I just ask that you pray with me this morning. Father God, we come to you this morning and we appreciate everything it is that you have done for us. God, we appreciate this time to gather together and worship, to sing praise, to sing and to acknowledge things we believe to be true about you. About what you have done for us and about the work that you intend to do through our community. God, this morning we remember those who are sick, those who are ill, those who are not 100% and have to be separated and isolated for various reasons. God, we lift up Brother Bart to you as he continues to grow stronger and to continue in his treatment. We lift up many others, God, with various needs that they have. We pray that your hand of healing and comfort would be with them. We just love you and thank you. Amen.
They tell me of a home far beyond the skies. Oh, they tell me of a home far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm.
Oh, you okay?
Good.
You're good?
I'm good.
Oh, stand up. Wait, stand up right here. I'll get you. You're good?
Ooh, that was a nice save.
All right, you're good?
I'm going to hold this.
Let's try that again while you're going up. Good? Good? Great? Okay. We are going to take children's sermon a little more literally this morning, right? What do you want to preach about this morning? Wait, remember what we talked about? What do you want to tell us about?
Well, we talked about a game.
Games. What game do you like to play?
Tag.
You like to play tag? Okay. What? How do you play tag?
You run and then you try to get another person by touching them.
Yeah, you run and you try to get another person by touching them. What about sports? What sports teams do you like?
The Dodgers.
The Dodgers. Good. What else?
The Chiefs.
The Chiefs. Good.
The Tigers.
The Tigers. Good. What else?
Cardinals.
Yeah, well, we talked about that. Yeah, the Cardinals. Listen, Dodgers are still playing. Cardinals aren't. So that just means that Dad gets disappointed later in the season than Mom does. Yeah. All right, good. Why do you like these teams?
Because they're my favorite.
Because they're your favorite? Okay. So if you are a fan of the Tigers, right, can you be friends with somebody who's a fan of the Kentucky Wildcats? No. It's easy to be friends with them today because we won, right? Yeah, right? When you play tag, can you still be friends with somebody who tags you? Yeah? But that just means that you lost the game, right? How can you still be friends with them?
You can play again.
You can play again, yeah. And we have rules, and we have competition, and we have a certain system, right? We have systems. Sure, you're five, just agree. We have systems that tell us how things work, right, with sports, with games. But when you're five, when the game's over, you're still friends with everybody, right? And it doesn't matter if you were on the same team. You're going to school in person now, right?
Mm-hmm.
What were you excited about getting to play at recess?
Wait, the day when it was raining?
No, the day when it wasn't raining.
I was most excited. Well, one day I was most excited that I get to play with other toys.
With other toys and basketball, right? Yeah, you got to play basketball at New Haven. And even though you were separated onto teams, you were still all Miss Maddox's kindergarten class. And you all got along, right? Right. Now, there are things as Christians and people in church that are different, right? Mom likes the Cardinals. I like the Dodgers. Some people like different things. People have different favorite colors. But we all belong to Jesus, right? And since we all belong to Jesus, then we're all united as one, right? Do you want to pray for us? You want me to? Okay. All right. God, I thank you that you have made us one, that we are united in you through your Son, Jesus, and that we can be one with one another just as Jesus is one with you, that we can live as friends and brothers and sisters and in perfect community, no matter what other things might be different about us. And we just love you and thank you. Amen. Good job, buddy.
Some people think you're distant, just some words on a page, that you're nothing more than fables handed down along the way. But I've seen you part the waters when no one else could pull me from the deep. That's who you are to me. Some people think you just live in cathedrals made of stone, but I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. And I've seen you in a sunset and in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me. You're amazing, faithful, love's open door when I'm empty. You fill me. know that I get stronger when I'm talking to you down on my knees. You're everything I need. You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. Who you are to me. You're forever holy. You're the Lamb who is worthy.
Okay, Isaac, we'll explain to Bart while there's a tooth mark on the pulpit when he gets back. No, you don't want to explain to him? I thought for sure you were coming back up with a bloody lip, buddy. Good job. Good job. All right, we're continuing to talk about politics, but really about something much more important. We're talking about, can we love unconditionally if we disagree politically? And again, we've talked about how this is really difficult. How this is something that's hard to do, because the hardest thing is to put our faith filter ahead of all of our other filters. To put the ways that we think about things, to filter things through who Christ says we are first, and then let our political identity be second. And this is something that's been really interesting as we've kind of gone through this, and I've gone through this with college students. And I've talked to certain people, but people have reached out, and I get the same kind of message over and over again. And the reason this is so hard is because we believe we've already done it. And again, I'm not picking on anybody, and I talk to the people who I'm going to say this about beforehand, but the type of comments is, David, those sermons are so good, I wish so-and-so could do this. David, I agree 100%. I just hope so-and-so is listening, right? And I get this from college students, and I've gotten this just a little bit here. And it's kind of across the board thing because, again, whatever you have experienced, you have formed your faith and your political identity as a result of your experience. And those things go together from your perspective. So we need to talk about the fundamental attribution error. This is a cognitive bias. I am not a ton of fun to watch debates or arguments or even the news with, because I like to point out when people are using cognitive bias and rational fallacies. And some people don't find that fun as you're just trying to watch the news. We don't watch a lot of news in my house. I watch it by myself. Yeah, right? And it's just better that way. It's good that way. Caitlin doesn't care that much about those types of things, and she cares even less about my commentary on the things that are happening, which is good. But let's talk about if someone is late. If you have set an appointment with someone and they are late, what do we think about them? oh, well, they must not care very much, or oh, they must not respect my time very much, or oh, that person's irresponsible and they're always late. That's just who they are. They're lazy, they're unorganized, right? But when we're late, oh, well, you know, I had a plan and this went wrong and it was unavoidable, so on and so forth. Maybe road rage is a better example, right? If somebody whizzes past you, it's like, well, okay, speed demon. And if you're stuck behind somebody else, it's like, why are you going so slow? The way you drive is what is exactly right, and everyone else is a moron, right? This is the fundamental attribution error. When it comes to someone else's behavior, we take their behavior and make it about something fundamentally wrong in their character. But when it comes to our behavior, there are environmental factors, there are things that can explain why that happened that way. And so we have this bias that other people have a character defect and we just have things happen. We do this in politics, right? If somebody is voting for Biden and we're not voting for Biden, it's, well, they're foolish, they're socialist, they're naive, they're ungodly, they have poor judgment. If somebody is voting for Trump and we are not voting for Trump, it's, well, they're hateful, they're racist, they're uncaring, they don't care about justice, right? I did a survey with my students this week and I asked them, we did it anonymously, who are you voting for? And so my students were about where I thought they were. They were split about 50-50. And then I asked, how excited are you to be voting for your particular political candidate? The overwhelming answer was meh. That was one of our options, meh, M-E-H. None of them are, well, I had one. I had one that put they are very excited for their candidate. The guy that they're voting for is their guy. They're about him 100%. Because here's the thing, though. There's not a perfect person. There's not a perfect political candidate. But when our politics filter comes before our faith filter, self-preservation says that we have to protect our guy as perfect because it's our best chance as a country. When Christ is our best chance as a country. We must be kingdom people who use our influence to influence our party, our platform, our people. When forced to choose between two imperfect candidates, as Christians, we have to be willing to call out the imperfections in our own people, in the people who we are supporting. We have to be willing to call these things out. And not just for our sake, and certainly not for our party's sake, but for the world's sake. When we say that this person is the best Christianity has to offer, regardless of who it is, and we put anybody else in that position except for Jesus, we do the world a disfavor. We are people who represent Christ first. First. Anyone else you may represent is second. But in everything you do, you represent Christ first. In everything you say, in all the decisions you make, in all the ways you interact with the people around you, you represent Christ first. And every other person you represent, your political party, your boss, your work, your church, those things are second. And we have to filter through, how do I represent Christ first? And this is a big deal. When I do a study with students and we look at the early church, or we look at some of the letters that were written to early church, one of the resources I really like to do is we actually have some letters back and forth from a guy named Pliny the Younger and Trajan the Emperor, who was the ruler of Rome. This is about 45 years after Paul is killed, about 45 years after this. So this is early in the life of the first church. And Trajan says that there is a group of people who are a threat to Rome. And so he's writing to one of these guys, Pliny the Younger, who lives here, and they write back and forth. And Emperor Trajan asks Pliny the Younger to look into it. What are these people doing? Why are they such a threat? And so Pliny the Younger sends some people, sends them to infiltrate the Christians, and their letters back and forth, while hard to read, are hilarious. Because the report reads something like this. The Christians meet before dawn on a certain day, Sunday, as they celebrate Christ resurrected. Again, at this point, Sunday is still a work day. They meet before dawn to celebrate Christ, and they sing hymns responsively to Christ as if he were a god. And then they make an oath to one another, not an oath to crime, but to live ethical lives. And then they make an oath to one another to treat others well, and then they leave. This dangerous, subversive group is gathering together, singing, and agreeing to do well. That's the big threat to the empire. And it really was. We see a lot of things happening historically with Rome, but Christianity continued to grow. And the way that the Christian community existed went against all of the social norms that made sense in Rome. And we see this addressed in Galatians. There's neither Jew nor Gentile. Now, the Jewish people were among the first Christians, of course, because that's who Jesus was ministering to. Jesus himself being Jewish and a rabbi, a teacher, drawing others to his teaching. And now it expands to those who are Gentiles. And we see that there are a lot of issues with that in the early church as they figure out how to navigate those waters. But now they're here together and they're not separated by this thing that has separated them forever. Neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free. Again, slavery exists different in the first century that we understand it from our American perspective. In America, slavery was about racism, about one people group subjecting another as inferior. In the first century, anyone is potentially someone else's slave. It is about who is in power, which was part of the appeal of being a Roman citizen. They were the superpower of the day, and so if you were a citizen of Rome, there was a certain level of protection that your people wouldn't be taken over and made slaves. But anybody is potentially somebody else's slave if power changes hands and your people lose. Or if you owe a debt you cannot pay, you can be taken in. Or your children could be taken in as slaves. Now, as a culture, when anybody could become a slave, the worth and value of women plummets within that culture. And so then we see this next one. They are neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female. You are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Everybody is together in this. And this radical inclusion within the body of Christ didn't make any sense from a cultural point of view. But it was appealing. It was appealing to people who had been marginalized. It was appealing to people who had been mistreated. And then, as they lived under the law of Christ, as their conscience, their collective conscience, was informed by how it is that they treat other people, love one another as I have loved you. By this they will know that you are my disciples. As they loved each other as Christ had loved them, it transformed the world. This small movement could not be stopped because love changed things. The way that Christ had instructed them to live together changed things. And so what we see is culturally disruptive unity. People that had no business getting along loved each other. People whose entire worldview was completely different, people whose stations in life were vastly different, loved and cared for each other as Christ had cared for them all. And as this continued to happen, the empire could not resist the change that was happening. And so it transformed the world. Not because of how good they were at arguing they were right. Not because of at how strong and powerful they were. There was not this political influence. There was no territories. There was no government influence. They just loved. And that's what made the difference. That's what made the change. And we are still a part of that same movement. You and I are sitting here today. We are joining online. We are here because we want to be a part of this movement. We want to be unified as one under Christ. We want to live as community the way that Christ has told us to. We're here because we believe there is something to the promises of God. We're here because we believe that life as a Christ follower is the best way to live our entire lives. We are here because we believe that we are kingdom people first. It is easy to think poorly of people, to buy into the political rhetoric that someone is fundamentally flawed if they support the other candidate. But emotionally intelligent people don't do that. Mature people don't do that. This is what's hard, because here's what's true. It will not be the end of the world if Joe Biden is elected president. It will not be the end of the world if Donald Trump is elected president. We know that to be true. Campaign commercials, on the other hand, do not know this to be true, right? And so it's that fear tactic that they want to drive everybody back to their own corners. They want to make sure that you're ready for a fight against what they deem is dangerous. And politically, we are divided on this to some degree or another. And churches who are not, I don't think, are diverse enough. Churches who are not divided on this in some way, I think, need to be more outreach-oriented. There will always be some division on this. We talked about this last week, because the stand we take depends on where we have sat. The stand we take depends on what experiences have shaped our beliefs. So there will be differences in political opinions. But those things are not the end of the world. Jesus, on the other hand, does talk about the end of the world. In Matthew, one of his last teachings before the Last Supper and then leading into the events that lead towards his death, he talks about the end of the world. In Matthew 25, he says this: "But when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit upon his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered in his presence, and he will separate the people as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you fed me. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me into your home. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you cared for me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then these righteous ones will reply, 'Lord, when did we ever see you hungry or feed you? Or when did we see you thirsty and give you something to drink? Or a stranger and show you hospitality? Or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you?' And the king will say, 'I tell you the truth, when you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me.' Then the king will turn to those on the left and say, 'Away with you, you cursed ones, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his demons. For I was hungry, and you didn't feed me. I was thirsty, and you didn't give me a drink. I was a stranger, and you didn't invite me into your home. I was naked, and you didn't give me clothing. I was sick and in prison, and you didn't visit me.' Then they will reply, 'Lord, when did we ever see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and not help you?' And he will answer, 'I tell you the truth, when you refused to help the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were refusing to help me.' And they will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous will go into eternal life." That is what Jesus describes as the end of the world. That's what Jesus describes as the judgment at the end of days, how it was that we cared for other people. Now, we started with how it is that we are called to care for one another within this body, within the body of Christ as disciples, that we are to love one another as Christ has loved us. But in that, we are given one purpose. We are given one mission, and we are given one command. We have our marching orders. We know what is expected of us. It is very hard to do that, because the other filters get in the way. The other filters start to come first. The other concerns start to creep in. And it's easy to get distracted from what it is that God has called us to do. And not only that, in a world that seems to be in absolute turmoil, it is hard to determine who needs our care and what the best way to demonstrate care is. We see this drawn out over and over again throughout the Gospels and in the Old Testament as widows and orphans. We see God asking and in fact punishing the Israelites for not caring for the widows and orphans. We see Jesus talking about this again. We see Paul and Peter talking about this again. Widows and orphans being those who were most marginalized in a patriarchy, being those who had no means to provide for themselves in the system of the day. And so as we look around the world, there are plenty who need help. There are plenty who need justice. And that's what I talked about with my students on Monday night. We talked about justice and judgment, because that tends to be the weapon, as we think about left and right, that get lobbed back and forth. Well, you don't care about social justice. Well, you don't care about judgment. Well, you're not practicing good judgment. And those who are claiming and asking for justice, they weren't practicing good judgment. And we see these words back and forth, justice and judgment. And in fact, social justice has become almost an insult that the church wants to separate itself from. And regardless of what the connotation of social justice is in the 21st century, Jesus was concerned with social justice. Christians, for all of our history, have been concerned with social justice. Now, I understand that parts of those words have evolved beyond what we maybe mean, but we are a people who care about social justice because we are a people who care about God's justice and who want to demonstrate Christ's grace. But judgment and justice are usually found together. When we read through and we look at the prophets, we see God sending prophets to talk about his judgment of the way that his nation has failed, because they have failed to institute his justice. And as we vote, and as we discuss politics, and as we think about what we do next, we are people of judgment and justice. We are people who want to use our best judgment, who want to think through and have the law of Christ inform our conscience in what it is that we will vote on. All the way from president to local elections to ballot measures, what does our best discernment and judgment tell us will bring Christ's justice more into the world? But that is just the beginning. That is a responsibility. I in no way want to communicate that your engagement in politics is unimportant. It absolutely is. It absolutely is essential. But it cannot be the end of your institution of God's justice and judgment in the world. You should vote for candidates that represent your Christian values, but then you should act in such a way that represent your Christian values. James 1 says this: "Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires. So get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the word God has planted in your hearts, for it has the power to save your souls. But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves. For if you listen to the word and don't obey it, it is like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, walk away, and forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. If you claim to be religious but don't control your tongue, you are fooling yourself and your religion is worthless. Pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for the orphans and widows in their distress and refusing to let the world corrupt you." All of us are at risk of the world corrupting us because fear corrupts. There are many things that we are afraid of. There are many sources that are trying to make us afraid. And we have to resist the corruption of the world. We have to look to the Word of God. We have to look to what God has instructed us to do and not just read it, but do it. But do it. And again, this is a sermon that I want you to take just for you. If you are thinking of anyone else, you are doing it wrong. Me too. Me too. I have written this sermon for me. I am trying to think about these concepts for me because there's not a single one of us who does this well enough. All of us fall prey to the corruption of the world. And I don't mean that as some sort of boogie monster that you need to, you know, lock yourself in a basement and not let your kids watch Harry Potter. I mean, maybe that was just a thing in my own tongue. I mean that the fear that turns the engines of the political process, the fear that raises money so that these politics can run more campaign, these politicians can run more campaign ads. That fear is the corruption of the world. And when we buy into that fear rhetoric, it separates us. It divides us. And we fall prey to thinking there is something wrong with someone's character if they have come to a different conclusion than us. And that's simply not true. Now, that doesn't mean that there's some sort of universalism, that everybody is right from their own perspective and that we can't correct or change anything. That's not true. It would actually be easier if that were true. What's hard is you are wrong. I am wrong. None of us is Christ. None of us is God. So all of us have to continue to do the work to identify where we are wrong. There are areas where you are wrong, and someone else's insight and experience will help correct you. But you will not find and identify those areas if you are only looking to point out where other people are wrong. This is where we have to go to people in relationship first. To listen, to learn, to love. To understand their experience. To understand how they would come to reach a decision that is so radically different than your own. This is best to do within the body of Christ first. Because we have a fundamental thing that we can agree on. Then from there, we really should have these discussions about politics. A lot of my students are like, yeah, in my church, in my family, in my group, we just agree. We don't talk about those things because it goes better if we don't. That isn't what leads us to unity. I'm not saying Thanksgiving, you'd be like, hey, let's ruin a good time. No, I'm saying find people that you are safe with. Find people who you know love you and care about you enough to tell you when you're wrong. Who love you and care about you enough that they can have a conversation about beliefs without taking it or making it personal. Who can think about your experience without making it about a fundamental flaw in your character. And then the other part of it is for you to do the same. That someone can come to believe something different than you without being flawed of character. And then together, not that we will all agree, but that we can grow in the ways that we understand. Agreement isn't the goal. Understanding is the goal, and those are not the same thing. Now, you may change your mind, and there's nothing wrong with you if you do. You may change a position, and there's nothing wrong with you if you do. And it is never, you're never at a point where it's like, well, I can't change my mind now. I literally had a student who's 20. He's like, well, I've gone this far with this political belief. I'm like, what? You're 20. And I get it. I'm only 31. But I really think it's okay to change if you think you should. And he's like, eh, maybe. I'll think about it. Okay. Well, but we all make this mistake. We think, well, I've gone this far. That is the sunk cost fallacy, but that's another thing. And so it's hard to change, and I get that. But we have to put that faith filter because sometimes the hardest thing to do is love. And some of us are bad at doing this because we are afraid, because our fundamental understanding of the world is limited. we don't have to be afraid because the one who created the entire universe loves, created, and cares about you. And regardless of what position you hold, and regardless of what things have happened in your life to lead you to that position, you are loved and cared for by the one who created everything. And the person who disagrees with you fundamentally on every one of your core beliefs was also made, created by, and cared for by God. And that's sometimes hard for us to accept. We know it in theory, but it's hard for us to remember. And so that's why we have to do it like looking in a mirror. Sometimes we forget what our own face looks like. And if it's easy for us to forget our own face, it's that much easier to forget the face of God. And we see it in everyone we meet. Stand as we sing our hymn of response this morning. Continue to pray for those in our congregation. I ask that you pray for the BSU too. I've got about 115 of them that kind of come and go back and forth. And so we're trying to be very, very, very careful. But it's one of those things, there's just so many unknowns. So check in on somebody this week. Check in on somebody you haven't seen. Have a great week. I think we'll be back to normal next week. Mark Pauly, will you pray to dismiss us this morning, please? Amen. Amen.